Recorded books and one-click digital present Into the Valley by Ruth Galm, narrated by Eliza Foss. 1. She took the forged check to the bank and cashed it. From there, she walked to the drugstore. She bought tampons and a candy bar. She did not in that moment think of what else she might need, and coiled the rest of the bills in a roll in her bra strap because it didn't feel right to have them in her purse. It was a strange bulge at her shoulder, papery and hard, but the sheath was loose enough to hide it. She rode the bus over the hill to her apartment and waited at the corner for the landlady to leave for her daily groceries. It was a basement apartment with no direct light and a dank stone smell, no matter what carpets and furniture and ceramic vases of lilies Bee had tried to add to it. A small kitchenette had been built in the corner around a dump sink, and she had added a formica table and two chairs, but the corner still radiated a metallic damp smell. There was a small room next to the bathroom that she'd planned to use as a study or a hobby room, but her only hobby was reading, and it made the carsickness worse to read in that cramped space with no natural light, so she left it empty. She knew, in the end, none of it amounted to anything people wanted to hear about in conversation. In a vinyl bag, she gathered a few dresses, underwear, a nightgown, alongside her ostrich skin purse. She went to her dresser and drew out the velvet box with a diamond brooch she had not touched in 2 years. When she had everything, she took the bus to a car lot on Van Ness. She had seen the Mustang for sale for months, glittering blue in the bright fog bleached light, the elongated trunk like the snout of an alligator, she thought, and the body just as slinky and low to the ground. It was a V8 engine, the salesman warned her.
You don't know what kind of power an engine like that has. Out of nowhere, you're flying.
He tried to sell her a Chevrolet, what he called a more appropriate car, or a Chrysler, a car more for someone your type. But she excused herself to the ladies' room and extracted the exact amount for the Mustang from the largest bills in the bra strap. She got behind the wheel and backed out self-consciously as the salesman watched. The steering wheel was large in front of her, hard, thin metal and tight plastic coating. The engine jumped at a touch to the gas. As she made her way carefully out of the car lot onto Van Ness, she did not even think of it as leaving, only going away. She drove through the city and east across the bridge and wanted simply to put the relentless appeal of the water behind her. The freeway skirted green piney hills dotted with cottages. She imagined them filled one by one with women, mothers, and housewives, and she wondered, very genuinely, how they filled their days, whether they arranged to come down and buy vegetables and attend luncheons, or preferred to stay in the cottages as long as they could. She switched on the radio. A song was playing that had played at her first high school dance, and she remembered the peach satin dress and the perfume her mother dabbed at her wrists, and the brill-creamed boy. And for a moment, she was taken with the same abstract hopefulness she'd had that night, that something she'd been waiting for would arrive and overtake her. But when the song ended, a commercial jangled on, and she found only rock and roll on the next two stations, until finally she flicked the radio off and listened instead to the asphalt brakes beneath her. She left the green mountains and followed the freeway along the bay, the water seeming never to recede, snaking ever inland. Finally, she came to another, smaller bridge, and there was no water after that. She felt an inexplicable relief There were a few houses on the side of the freeway and a roadside nightclub with unlit neon palm trees on its roof. And then, suddenly, she was in the Golden Hills. They were a sere, sad blonde. As the Mustang took the grade through the treeless, waterless land, she did not think of the money at her shoulder, or the possessions she'd left behind, or her secretarial job at the law firm to which she would not return. When she reached the top of the hill, she took her foot off the gas and coasted downward to the flat valley below and thought of nothing. 2. The teller had asked her, glancing at the ostrich skin purse, if she liked the new tapestry handbags. "They're like something out of Mary Poppins," Bee had said. The teller nodded in agreement. She had beautifully applied shimmer eyeshadow. She counted the bills out sharply and brushed back a lock of washed and set hair, the first bank Bee would never forget because of these details and because of the first flush of expansive coolness, the lines and the marble and the calm suffusing her. She had smiled at the soigné teller and breathed without spinning and pocketed 3,000 stolen dollars. 3. Did you like the new salon? Do you have a date this week? Her last conversation with her mother had been exactly like the others. I've decided, by the way, that I really prefer the pearlescence for manicures. Underneath, the carsickness had drummed as though to seam apart her skull. She answered the questions by rote, and through the drumming an indistinct thought pulsed, as blurred and throbbing as the pain. There must be another conversation they were meant to have, some other point to which they could apply their exchange. "Are you not feeling well?" her mother asked. "No. Be sure to take some air. It'll brighten your skin." And with that, Bee had hung up the phone. 4. She rolled down her window. Heat blasted her cheek. She exited the freeway and took a road next to some railroad tracks, rusted boxcars abandoned in a long chain. The wind whipped through the interior, smelling of vinyl and exhaust. She stepped on the gas. The irony was that she felt the carsickness less in the car. The irony was that the carsickness had nothing to do with actually being in one. She drove past a lone barn newly painted white and a couple of one- and two-room shacks next to the road, canted picket fences lost in tall grass, dirty old trucks in the driveways. She passed the brown skeleton of a structure, not burned but somehow bared to its dark wooden bones, ringed by no trespassing signs on trees all around. It looked to her in its openness like an ancient place of worship, and she felt a brief urge to stop and sit inside its timbers. But she drove on. A sign read 60 miles to Sacramento. She could go see the Capitol. She knew dimly that she would not. She knew dimly that she would never go near another city again. 5. The valley was because of the man on the bus. She tried always to smile at people in public, as her mother had taught her, to look polite and receptive, and they mistook this for an invitation to unburden themselves, when in fact she didn't really even want to talk. When he found out she was from the East, the man told her about the long table of land just beyond the mountains and bay.
Nothing happens there. Not one thing. That's why, he explained, the Easterners never even knew about it. No pretty scenes, no trees, just flat. I won't go back in a million years. She could see in the man's features. He was young, with large pores glazed in oil and jagged purple veins on his eyelids, something strained and unbalanced. His eyes blazed. He began to mumble. But I'm safe here. I really am. B listened politely for a few more seconds, then got off the bus two stops before her own. And yet, since the encounter, her thoughts had often drifted to this valley. She imagined that in this long, unvarying plain, all the contradictions of the city might fall away, that its bareness would reveal something, provide an answer she had failed to acquire. A place of unvarnished truth to which she must go. Because it was no longer just the dirty young people in the city who disturbed her. In the restroom at iMagnon recently, she'd encountered a mother and her teenage daughter. The girl with clear breasts and long legs as tall as the woman. But the daughter was trying to pull her skirt off. "I'm not sure I want to be wearing it all day," she said. "What if I get cold? What will I do?" The mother hushing and soothing her, keeping the girl's hands from the skirt while the girl shuddered. Bee washed herself quickly, but the mother looked straight at her, voice harried. "She's only 10. She looks older, but she's only 10. Bee had nodded and run out. Six. What she had not thought through were the logistics. She had not considered how in this tabula rasa she would find the banks. This new state of affairs, this new exigency, she did not question. She only knew she would find them. Seven. She had renamed herself B, period, after college. She thought that was the beginning of the problem. She'd never felt like a Beverly, never known what a Beverly should want to do. The sing-song syllables and the lift at the end like a promise made without her agreement, disorienting her. So she'd erased it. People heard it as B, B-E-A, and that was fine with her, as long as she could think of herself as B, period. Something opened up, went blank in a way she could tolerate for a time. Eight. The paper sliding across marble, the teller's anodyne voices. Later, it was all spoiled by the glint of the knife, the blood, the expression on Daughtry's face as she drove away. But by then, it no longer mattered. Nine.
Because you're a good girl, they'll like you. Because you look normal. And you act normal, and you've done up your hair, and you've walked in the right way, with class. You're gonna fool them blind. Because I've always told you, you're a good, classy girl, and that won't ever change,
Daughtry had said to her. Part 1. Chapter 1. The car was low on gas. She had not checked the gauge before leaving the lot, and she flushed at the thought of the salesman making a joke of her. No, she had not wanted a Chevy or a Chrysler. She knew this instinctively,
although she might only have been able to say it was the look of the car. Something strong and sharp in the Mustang that pared it down to a single purpose, an inarguable direction. She'd never considered owning a car before. The subways and elevateds in the East had obviated any need, and perhaps more importantly, owning her own car had seemed somehow unseemly. The women in advertisements lounged around cars in feather boas in the company of tuxedoed dates or carted bags of groceries to the back of a station wagon, and so she had tried to put the thought out of her mind, like some lurid afternoon fantasy. But the empirical beauty of the Mustang had stayed with her, and the car was the first thing she thought of after the check. There were no buildings in sight. The July heat made her arms and back sweat, moistening and drying and moistening again. Her left arm turned red in the sun. The city never got hot. Even on the warmest days, she shivered, her toes chilled. She wetted her dry lips and tried to put the anxiety about the gas out of her mind. And when she began to see the first rows of fruit trees, she turned into a dirt lane and parked. Hundreds of peach trees. She rolled down her stockings and took off the bone-colored heels. The ground was dry and hard, the trees not high but in full leaf, crammed with hard orange peaches. She walked until she found a good spot to sit down. The tree was uncomfortable to lean against, and the branches too low, so she lay all the way down on her back and tried to relax. A hot day in her childhood, she had snuck into a vacant lot and lay hidden and cooled in the overgrown grass among the sounds of cars and birds and cicadas. She'd been convinced of the fact she was erased from the world and breathed easy and fallen asleep. She couldn't remember another day like that since. She ate her candy bar, moving her tongue along her teeth for the chocolate and clumps of coconut, and pondered the sky through the peaches. Her throat was dry. She had nothing to drink. It was somewhere after 1 o'clock on a Tuesday, and no cars passed. She tried to keep lying as she had in the vacant lot those years ago, but the dirt was hard and she was not hidden, and eventually she went back to the car and drove on. She passed a horse corral. No people seemed to be around anywhere. The sun blazed on the animals, their heads bent under the heat, their bodies a liquid brown. They seemed to be, in their unconsciousness, in a state of total equanimity. After the horses came a stretch of dry, uncultivated land, and then, finally, there was a gas station. She filled up and went to the small bathroom at the back of the building. She saw that the whole back of her dress was dirty. The ivory had not been a wise decision, not for driving or sitting in the dirt, not for the second day of her period. Her underwear had spots of blood where her tampon bled through. She never paid enough attention to when her period might arrive, and so was never prepared. And when it did come, she seemed, irrationally, to disbelieve that it could require more than one or two tampons. That the blood would run on and on for so many days. She was invariably left with soiled underwear and bloody fingers. She took out the tampon and put another in and folded toilet paper over the blood spots. She went inside the store to pay for her gas, not touching the money in her bra. In her purse was a compact, a gold tube of lipstick, gum wrappers, aspirin, a few crumpled bills, and the checkbook. A middle-aged woman with bleached hair looked at her blankly from the cash register. "Do you have a water fountain?" B asked the woman. The woman did not acknowledge her question, just put down her magazine and went back behind a gray door and emerged with a paper cup of water.
You on your way to Reno? The woman asked.
No.
The woman looked annoyed.
Do you sell maps? B asked. The woman flicked her chin toward the back of the store. B walked to a revolving rack. She picked up a map of the state. Do you have anything just for the valley? She called to the woman.
The valley? The woman frowned. That's all we have over there.
By the time B returned to the counter, the annoyance had set into the woman's features, and she pushed the change toward B and went back to her magazine without looking up again. B laid the map across the passenger seat, hundreds of black names on pastel. She'd only wanted a small patch to concentrate on, just a piece. She folded the map up. The heat in the car and the smells of hot metal and plastic drugged her. She closed her eyes and leaned her head back against the square seat. She must have fallen asleep because next the woman from the gas station was rapping at her windshield.
There's no loitering here, she said. Can't just park all day at the pumps. We got other customers, you know.
B rubbed her eyes. The woman glared at her. B looked around. There were no other cars. I'm sorry. I guess I was tired. The woman crossed her arms, the tan skin draping. Is there a bank somewhere around? B asked.
Go back to Sassoon City, or on to Rio Vista. There's nothing in between.
For a moment, B thought the woman said something else under her breath. But the woman only continued to glare from behind the sagging arms, and B had no way of knowing if she was right. When she came on Sassoon City, the small main street and the pale tile buildings were quaint. But the marina behind the town startled B. Just like that, a row of boats in blue-brown water, masts bobbing against the flat yellow. She felt suddenly that the bay was following her, leaking out in a last menacing grab through the marsh stalks. She jotted a random amount on the check. Good afternoon, ma'am. The pretty teller standing among the calm straight lines and muted oil paintings. It's Miss, actually. Oh, I'm sorry, ma'am. I mean, Miss. But the cool, expansive feeling still came. B felt so light and cheerful afterward, she considered shaking the girl's hand, then thought better of it. As she walked back to the Mustang, the odd, misplaced marina did not disturb her in the least. Back on the road, the heat and sleepiness were too much. She searched for a motel and had to return to the freeway to find a motor inn with a billboard of a bikini-clad woman diving into a pool. B did not turn on the air conditioner when she got inside the room, just let the heat melt over her as she lay on the bed. She took the money out of her bra strap. It was now at least a dozen $50 bills. She had no interest in counting them. She rifled through the vinyl travel bag, pulling out for a moment the velvet box with a diamond brooch, then replacing it. Instead, she took out a bottle of nail polish. The room was darkening, but she left off the light. She thought of nothing but smoothing the pale iridescent pink from the brush of the nicely piquant smell. She'd watched her mother at her vanity making her toilette, the French word she'd taught B for pinning her hair, applying her lipstick, dabbing a crystal perfume bottle at her neck, each gesture accruing to her some invisible potency. Her mother had once given her the last tortoiseshell compact of her favorite face powder, a discontinued line, and B kept it intact and untouched, like a totem, unsure what might happen if she finished it. When her nails were painted, B lay down again with her palms flat against the bed and fell asleep. She woke on her side, the nail polish fretted with lines from the bedspread. She had dreamed of the landscape from the car, the contourless vista, a stream of yellow and white and green with no signs of people. And in the dream, she had decided she would follow this land forever. Chapter 2. The next morning, the blood of her period had soaked through the toilet paper in her underwear. There was only the slightest brush of it on the inside of her dress. She hesitated to change. It was as if quitting the dress would disturb a key element to her new fluid state. To bathe, she sponged her armpits and her crotch and inserted a new tampon and put on new underwear. She threw the stockings from the day before in the trash, feeling vaguely guilty, but it was too hot. Then she worked on her face, the moisturizer and powder, the liquid liner at her eyes, and the lipstick and perfume last. She pinned her hair back in place. There were young girls in the city now who let their hair go naturally, who never wore makeup, whose clothes were ill-fitting. These girls distressed Bea. She'd forgotten a toothbrush. She walked from the motel toward a gas station. There was no town, only the motel. The pool in the daylight was small and chipped, a telephone booth, the gas station with a general store attached, and another street across the intersection. Her heels crunched in the pebbles along the road, the freeway cars moaning and thumping beside her. The morning sun already burned her shoulders. A watery brown haze at the edge of the sky stung her eyes. At the store, she bought a toothbrush and toothpaste, a donut, and a cup of coffee. "I'm just taking a tour of the valley," she found herself saying to the paunchy older man at the cash register. "I just thought it would be very interesting." She tried not to hear her own voice.
"Pretty hot time of year to choose." The man's neck was a loose pink.
"Well, I don't have anything pressing in town right now. Nothing I can't miss." The man nodded, as if this was clear, and handed her the donut and paper cup. As she drank the coffee in the shade of the building outside, she told herself there would be no police after her. What she'd done was not big or serious enough. And she was pretty. People had always seemed to like this. Her nose was aquiline, her lids heavy, but eyes almond-shaped, this combination giving her, she'd been told, a bedroom quality. She had never experienced this quality, but understood it appealed to people, and so drew her eyeliner out to feline points at the sides of her eyes and kept her hair blonde. She was aware from the ballet lessons her mother had required that she moved with her shoulders down and neck long, which people also took to be ladylike and contented. She walked across the intersection to the other street in the non-town. Two houses stood on it, one boarded up. The other was hidden by a wooden fence that, when she peered inside, was overrun with cacti. The cacti had clawed over a single arch of walkway to the door, everything else in the bramble dead and dry. A walnut tree bowed over the porch, the smell of dog feces baked in the sun, although no dog to be seen. She opened the gate. There were things she would not have done in the city. She'd wanted to enter a yard on one of the hills and peer into the mudroom at children's windbreakers on hooks and dirty sneakers lined up. She'd stopped herself. She stooped under the cacti. The freeway blew. No dog barked. When she reached the door, she knocked without a clear reason. She had a sense the owner here lived alone, and she wanted to speak with him. She could tell the person she was new to the valley, ask for tips. The windows were layered in dust. She knocked again, louder. On the porch under the windows was a collection, an enameled pot, several stones, tines of sharp antlers. B glanced around. She slipped a small antler bone into her purse. For luck. In the car, on the freeway, the non-town was already behind her. She tried to think of some current pop song, something fresh and summery to sing. But in truth, she didn't like the songs on the radio now. So she hummed her favorite parts from The King and I. It was 1967. In the spring, she had turned 30. Chapter 3. Bee had once watched a boy playing in a sandbox in the city. In a playground in her neighborhood, perched like all the playgrounds in the city, it seemed to her, precariously on a hill, as if it might fall off the side of the world. The mothers had been pretty in their makeup and scarves, their clipped, determined movements, hands darting in and out of a pram, through a small child's hair with leaves, admirable to be. But it was too draining to watch the women. They spoke too vehemently about items and opinions she did not understand. Her attention had settled instead on the boy. He poured the sand over his hand with such concentration, such absorption at the run of the dry grains on his fingers, that nothing else mattered. Nothing else touched him. Only the feel of the sand on his skin and the keeping of its cascading rhythm. Bee watched the boy until the mothers called him away, and after they'd gone, she felt strangely abandoned. As if she should have spoken to him. She got up and looked around to make sure no one was watching, and then sat in the sandbox. Following the boy's movements, she poured the sand over her hand. But she felt only the irritating, papery sensation on her skin, and when her knees began to ache from kneeling, she got up and left. She decided that the checks were for her, like the sand for the boy. And she did not let her mind go beyond this thought. Chapter 4. The radio announced a heat wave for the valley. Bee could not imagine it any hotter. The back of the ivory sheath had sweat through, and her limbs felt swollen. Her hair had half slipped out of its pins. She stopped at a restaurant on an exit. She brought her large makeup case into the bathroom and powdered and fixed her hair and unzipped her dress to spray perfume underneath. She ordered an iced tea from the waiter. The young man stared at her so intensely she wondered for a moment if she knew him from somewhere. She asked if he lived nearby, and he nodded without speaking. She remarked on the heat, and he continued to stare until finally he said, "Ma'am, your zipper's undone." She reached her hand to her back. Her dress was flared open. "Oh, thank you." She flushed to her neck. Her bra strap had fallen down her shoulder, and she smelled her own odor, still pungent under the perfume. She gripped the zipper awkwardly and pulled it up as far as she could. "Thank you," she mumbled. After he left, she pretended to study the menu with great absorption. A woman with three small children was the only other customer in the place. She sat two tables over but kept staring at Bee and the sky blue makeup case. The woman looked old and childlike at the same time, small-boned, a high forehead with deep lines. She was wearing a sundress with a stain at the breast. In one arm she held a baby, while two young children ran back and forth from the window to the table, eating half a French fry and dropping it on the floor, sucking the juice off a pickle and putting it back. The woman sat like a statue in the midst of it. "Do you live around here?" Bea asked. The woman's expression signaled the ridiculousness of the question. The baby squirmed. She hitched it higher and tighter on her lap, without once glancing at it. "I was just wondering if there was anything of interest to visit, for someone passing through." The woman looked at Bea as if she had asked for directions to China. A strand of thin hair fell across the lined forehead. "There's Old Town, I guess," the woman said finally. "If you like the gold rush stuff. They have a railroad museum there, I think." One of the children ran by and shoved the baby. The baby smiled wildly as if it was a game and not an aggression. "Oh, I won't be going to Sacramento, actually." The woman seemed to accept this as understandable. "There's the buttes," she went on the way to Chico. "Those are sort of strange. Just strange to look at out there all alone. But they don't let you drive in them. It's private land, I guess." She paused. "There's not much to see before Tahoe, really."
"They sound lovely. Thank you."
Bea absently fingered the handle of the makeup case. "I'm from the city," Bea added. The mother nodded curtly, as if to put a stop to this need to state the obvious. The baby was kicking its legs and whining. It tried again to scooch off her lap, but the woman's grip seemed an insensate vice. The baby gave up and sank back into watching the children, trapped, mesmerized.
"You traveling alone?" the woman asked.
"Yes."
"You lost or something?"
"No, just driving, just taking in the sights."
The mother picked up a French fry and swirled it in ketchup without eating it.
"Well, I'd go directly on to Reno if I was you. There's nothing to see before Reno. A lot of driving gets me irritated."
The baby finally let out its wail then, sharp and steady. The mother hauled it to her shoulder and slapped it on the cheek, which only made the baby cry louder. Just then, an adolescent boy opened the door of the restaurant and yelled,
"We're parked in the back. He's waiting. Come on."
The woman scooped up her purse and the baby and barked at the children to follow.
"Well, good luck with your trip," she said over the baby's shrieks. "The buttes, I guess. But I don't know if they're worth it."
And in a burst of chaos and sun, she was gone. The waiter finally brought her iced tea, and Bea twirled the straw, letting the ice circle. She looked out the window at the Mustang in the parking lot. The blue metallic sheen was already filmed with dirt. She tried to imagine the buttes. In her mind, they were snub-nosed, western, angular, removed. She left her tea and went back to the bathroom. Her eyeliner was still intact, but her pores large again, and her lipstick gone. She reapplied the powder and twisted up the lipstick and told herself once more that she was just taking in the sights, making an anthropological tour of the valley.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.